You are now listening to Femme Regard Podcast with Tessa Markle
and Carolina Alvarez.
Femme.
Hey, Femme fam. Welcome back. I'm going to say this for like every one of the first couple episodes per season, but like, I'm just so grateful for you guys listening. Just want to let you know. Thank you. We were very pleasantly surprised when we released the second season of how many listens we got like right away.
Yeah. No, that was really... Guys, that just made my life. So thank you. Thank you for listening and supporting and following and commenting. So all the good stuff, all the good stuff. And we're so excited to be doing season three and that we've got another round of amazing guest speakers and hopefully another round of new listeners coming on and following. So spread the word, spread the love.
Also, as far as our guests, you know, we're always looking for more guests. If you think you have something really cool to talk about, get a hold of us. Or like, you know, Sky that we had last season, it was through my friend Sarah. Shout out Sarah that
hey,
we got
Sarah.
Connected with her. So like, if you know somebody that you're like, oh my God, this person made this awesome film or they know all about this or that, like, let us know. We're always open to... You know, we don't have a list of all of our lined up guests. Like, we are open to new people.
Yeah. No, absolutely. So I guess
let's just talk about,
earthquakes. So California's had several. And when we were actually scheduling guests for this season, I was at Tessa's place, and that was when we felt the 6.9 one.
No, this was like 7.1. It's not that much bigger, I guess, but like still over 7's a big deal. Like, yeah, we're sitting on my bed.
Oh my gosh.
May or may not have been having a cocktail.
And then I picked someone up on Instagram using like a corny pickup line. What did they say? It was like the earthquake. I was like, was that an earthquake or did you just shake up my feet or something?
So if you need a topical pun that you can use as a pickup line.
I have a ton of them. It was just fun. We had that was a fun little night, but that was happening in California. So, you know, when we're scheduling, doing, you know, work on the grind, you know, we're facing more than one adversary.
Let's just say problem.
Why do I have to be weird and use a word I can't pronounce? Story of my life. No, it's been really fun getting the show together. And
this podcast, I just want to say, is like, it's a lot like making a film or a web series or whatever, because it's, you know, you have to figure out how to make it work and who you're going to bring on and how do you market it and all that stuff, you know.
Yeah.
So it's been fun and a learning experience.
Yeah. Another venture for us. And we hope we can connect to you guys better in that way. So I guess we're joking around that we wanted to talk about cults for this episode because
you'll see why with our next guest.
Yes, our next guest speaker. She's doing a short film kind of around that topic. But you know, speaking of doing short films, you know what Tessa and I, if you didn't listen to our season two episode, we kind of were talking about how this new project that we're kind of formulating and like, what do we were stuck in this limbo of, do we do it, make it a short film? Do we make it a feature?
Make it a series?
And I think we have a better grip on where it's going to go. Currently have it. I'm writing it as like a feature, but also can be broken up into episodic format, pretty simple, but that way I have a whole story written out. So that's kind of where we're at there. But
I mean, it's like, that's the first thing obviously you have to kind of decide with the story that you have in mind is like, what are you going to do with it?
Right. And I guess like I was kind of getting turned off to making shorts in the conversations that we were having last season. But I I think it's a good place to start, though. It is. And I was here's where I'm going to now throw in a positive on this whole thing. I had a kind of a flip. And that was when I met up with one of my filmmaker friends who just did a short. And I was like, oh, my God. Like, I kept telling him, I'm like, you need to make this into a feature. Like, this is so dope. Like, this is really good. And he was like, nah. I'm like, I'm going to keep the, you know, the characters and the world, but I'm going to just use this as my calling card. Like, I can say I self-produced this. Mm-hmm. I did all of this. I directed it. All of that is 100% me. And yes, yeah, on a, you know, a short film scale, but that is now, that can be my calling card. And I guess I kept getting wrapped up in this idea that you have to do a feature and distribute it in order to have like a title for yourself. Like that is the way to, I'm going to use the word legitimize just because we use that word way too much in our season one. But it was, it was a little bit like, okay, yeah, like that totally makes sense because it was done so well. I mean, yeah, I would, as an investor, be like, okay, if he's making a similar, and that's what he was also saying, was that this is very much the style, the genre, the stories that he wants to tell. So if you're doing that with your short, and that's kind of, I think that's a good goal to have. If you're doing another reason why maybe sticking to a short film, it's like you can still create a, you know, a, not a name, what's the word? Like, you know, your whole look reputation, what your stories that you want to tell with the short. And it, and if it's really well done, like, sure, you can get investors to put in money for a bigger feature that you want to produce along the same lines, because then they still have a good idea of what you did there.
Yeah, I think it's more important, yeah, to have quality content than to be just like pushing out the features, you know, because, OK, say you make a feature and you happen to know someone that is part of a, you know, distribution company. So they managed to get it out on the shelves of Walmart, but nobody's buying it because they've heard terrible things about it because it's not very good. Like, that's not going to get you anywhere. Right. So, you know, versus if you have a short film that, I don't know, maybe it made it into some of the big festivals or whatever. So enough people are seeing it and they're like, oh, my God, this is amazing. Like, go on iTunes right now and watch it. You know,
yeah,
that's way more. That's going to make a way better name for yourself, you know, and it's, it, you have something to really be proud of, too, versus just, oh, I made money off of this one, you know?
It's just been, you're always going to hear so many things and we're going to tell you so many things, but that's why we have this podcast, too. I think it helps us talk about the feedback we get with you guys, and you can hear our thoughts go and change and grow. And
yeah, I guarantee you we're going to say something or already have said something that will probably like
contradict itself. Yeah, totally. No, totally. And that's the beauty of this industry. I don't know if I'd call it beauty. It's a fun, you know, roller coaster ride where you're like, okay, this is working now, this isn't working now, and we hope to always bring you guys with the latest and greatest. But yeah, I think I now, like, I'm like, okay, yeah, short film, you know, at least you know, if it's done like you were saying, the quality of it is amazing, spectacular. Who's to say you can't use that to make something bigger or get investors by doing that? Because I didn't think about that. I was like, okay, well, it's just gonna sit there then. And like, okay, cool.
I mean, in a way it is, like, you know, it's true, it's gonna maybe get into festivals, but it's a short, so it's not gonna be, you know, show up in the movie theaters then after being the winner of, you know, Sundance or whatever, like, but and you're not gonna get it distributed probably because it is a short film. However, yeah, you could get it out there and use that to pitch and use that as, you know, like you said, your friend said, your calling card, and, you know, it shows at least the quality of your work. And I think it's a great way to start out as a filmmaker, either shorts or web series, both like short form kind of stuff, because it's like you're not spending as much money, so you're not making those ridiculously expensive mistakes. You're just making normal mistakes that you're going to learn from, you know, you're going to learn how everything works and what you like and, you know, all that kind of stuff. You got to start somewhere.
Yeah. And that's, short films are definitely a great place to start. We've learned that, and we tried to do a couple inexpensive ones, and you know, that's where you can go forth.
And, and web series too, I think. I just want to make sure we really mention that, because it's like they're both short short form format. Totally. Right?
I just laugh because we that's how we met.
Yeah, they're, you know, there's all different kinds, but I mean, if you look at like a lot of pretty big shows like Broad City and Insecure, like those girls all started out with web series, and they got followers doing that, and people loved what they did, so then they were able to get those investors and really like make actual series on TV.
I didn't know that. That's cool.
So you
it makes sense.
Yeah,
it totally makes sense. That's like, okay.
They started doing it themselves, doing it that way, and then made it big.
Totally.
Yeah. But that's another thing you have to consider too. If, you know, let's say a web series specifically, if you're doing it yourself and like trying to take that to then the next level eventually, is like, how do you get it out there? How do you get those viewers? And that's something we're constantly struggling with. I mean, nobody
just
really has the answers.
Pay someone to do it. That's the goal. Just pay everyone.
Yeah,
it's a lot easier when you have that
when you have the
money
to,
do it, you know. But that, I mean, I do think for Femme Regard, it would be great to start to build, you know, a more team of, with giving, you know, different responsibilities too, because we are doing so much. I mean, with the podcast, with creating other content and films and then our lives, you know, it's a lot. I mean, it's definitely doable, and we've been staying afloat, but yeah, I think it'll be an awesome time when we could be like, and you handle the social media,
right?
You know, we found, you know, tricks. And
well, social media is just such a big thing. You know, even if we're not working on a project at the time, we still have to keep up our social media presence, because that's what the world is right now.
Yeah.
Like, that stuff does matter much as we all hate it. Like,
yeah,
you know, keeping that presence and keeping your audience that you've already built up to date, so that they'll actually go out and say, oh, my friends have this production company and they have a podcast, and like, you should check them out. They're really cool. Like, you know.
Yeah, exactly. It's like a resume. It's like, yeah. A resume that is on 24/7 that you need to keep adding to.
Keep relevant.
That's the, yeah, that's how I would, the business person in me would be like, okay, I'm gonna keep this going.
Because if you think about it, it's kind of like, you know, those people that do actually have like their PR team that they pay and stuff, you know, they're out there getting them like the press interviews, right? Well, okay, maybe we can't connect with the press person. We don't have a big enough project to talk about, whatever. So like, social media is like doing our own press, because it's still getting it out there to a wide audience, and you know, we're in control, which is kind of nice.
Yeah, no, 100%. And I think it's just something you gotta, it's also in some ways a calling card too.
Yeah. I mean, I've started like, you know, okay, I don't know if this happens everywhere else in the country, but in LA, like, you meet someone and within 5 minutes they're like, so what's your Instagram?
Oh, all the time.
So now that people do that, I'm always like, oh, well, yeah, here, I'll type it in. But also, you have to follow my production company.
Hey, like, I love that.
You know, so yeah, you just gotta put yourself out there. And it doesn't have to be social media. You know, that's just what's big right now. But however you choose to do it, like, getting yourself out there as a filmmaker, but also as an actor, whatever it is you specify in, is so important. Mm-hmm. Because if you're out there, then your work will be out there too.
Absolutely. Well, I think that like
sums it up
for us.
I'll do my little inspo then.
Oh, please.
So I was on social media, funny enough, this morning, and my best friend from back home, shout out to Mandy, she is currently directing a production of Matilda at our community theater.
Aww.
Which, like, we grew up at this community theater together. I mean, I did shows there for like a decade, like every show I possibly
could.
Wait,
didn't you end up in the paper? Was that the same theater?
I mean, I've been in the paper a lot for them. I was there a long time doing a lot of stuff. But
that's so cute.
And her fiance made a little trailer, shout out to Andrew, which was really well done. I was really impressed. I texted him today. I was like, this is amazing. It's so professional. But it was such a cool thing to see, like, you know, it's a community theater production, right? So expect certain things from a community theater, but a lot of times you don't expect a lot, right? And this trailer looks like amazing. Like, I'm so excited for this cast and crew, and like the set is really like, it just, it looks like a full-blown like professional production. And that's so inspiring for me, is like, you know, growing up in a small town, doing community theater for years and feeling like, okay, I'm pretty good at this or whatever, but like,
yeah,
who's gonna ever see you, and who's gonna, you know, how yeah. are you ever gonna move up from that? And I mean, we have success stories from our little tiny Geyer Performing Arts Center in Scottsdale, Pennsylvania, of people that have gone on to Broadway and stuff. Like, it can happen for sure, you know. But just seeing like a super quality production come out of just little small town community theater is inspiring to me for sure. And like, there's kids involved with this. Like, I hope somebody gets to videotape
I was involved in the community theater as well. Mm-hmm. And just it's where youngins,
yeah.
you know, start to learn what that's all about. And
it's where I fell in love with performing, yeah. you know?
Aww.
Yeah.
Nostalgia. Taking it back, Tessa.
I know, right?
The summer camp days.
Oh, I know. Again, like I said earlier, gotta start somewhere, right?
Oh, totally. No, and it's beautiful when, you know, a community mm-hmm. keeps it up and does something, you know, goes. I feel like the arts department's always the one that gets like gypped first. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So it's nice to see that they've like, you know, even went the extra mile yeah. in certain areas too.
I mean, like, nobody's making money off of it. You know, it's just yeah. an experience for them. And I think that's beautiful.
Oh, I almost like Femme Regard give back. Like, we should, you know, when we're rich, one of these
days. Yeah, right.
That's awesome. I love that. I really do.
Yeah.
Well, thanks for the share, Boo.
Of course. I hope that inspired you guys as well. And we will see you next time.
Yes.
Dun, 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 dun.
Thanks for listening to Femme Regard Podcast. If you like what you hear, tune in next time for more tips on the filmmaking business and insightful conversations with industry professionals over tea.
We can only grow with your support, so please subscribe, share, rate, and give us a 5-star review on Apple Podcast. If you leave us a great comment, we might give you a shout out on the show. For more on us, check us out at femregard.com.